the difference of the loss that's going to be incurred?
Well, that's not part of the financials of the project. And I think I understand what you're saying. In the peer advisory task force, it was pointed out that a study was done in 2002, actually, that said there was a $40 million impact, not 74, by the peer. And I don't know what today's studies would say about what they are, but I think people go to the peer to go see it and experience it. I don't think it's going to be that much different, to be honest with you. But the direct, straightforward answer to your question is those financial impacts aren't part of what's been done. Yeah, Monica.
Thank you, Mars, for killing me. I'm Monica Abbott, I'm a beautiful District 1. You don't have to tell me about maintaining an older building. I have a 100-year-old home, and I am maintaining it every minute of the day and night. So, but in the course of doing that, every time I go to Home Depot or Lowe's or any of these places, it is incredible the new materials that are coming out. And I'm thinking, I just read an article in Discovery a Science magazine, about living roofs, and actually over in Venice, they're doing a project, which Venice is all water, where they are incorporating sea life and their ability to latch onto things and then make them stronger. So Venice is actually reinventing or saving their centuries-old buildings. And I wonder if any of this, I mean, even since the peer process started, technology has just medically, building science, it's just wild what is going on. And I wonder if any of that has been thought about. I mean, if Venice can do it, I think it'd be pretty hot to have St. Petersburg doing something so ecologically challenging and exciting. And I think that would get people from all over the world too.
As far as have those kinds of things been considered, sea animals or something reinforcing the structure, I think the answer to that is no. But I can tell you that if there's one thing that all of the documentation throughout the process agrees upon, is that the approach and the head, everything except for the yellow square that was on that one slide, the approach and the head, nobody disagrees, have to be replaced. And I just got to believe that if there was a way to avoid that, it would have been brought up. As far as I know, there's unanimous agreement that the approach and the head that were built in 1926 have to be replaced. Whether you replace them as they are today or replace them with something else, they have to be replaced. Yeah?
You're talking approach and head. Is this that the bridge?
I'm sorry?
The approach head, is that just the bridge?
It's the square around a building. It's the platform around the pyramid.
So the pyramid's up.
The pyramid sits on four caissons, which are submerged 20 by 20 steel encased concrete structures. Okay? When the peer advisory task force was put together, the reports that were available to them indicated they didn't do an underwater survey of the caissons. What they did was they said the caissons were built in 1973 when the inverted pyramid was opened. Structures like those have a 50-year life. So the report said we expect those caissons will have to be looked at in 2020 to determine the situation. Now I can tell you, and this is something, thank you, because you pointed out something I also want to point out. Some of the money that we spent on the lens, and I think it's a good amount of the sum of the money we've spent on the lens, is going to be productive, usable expenditure no matter what we build. We've done a full geotechnical survey of the soil and the surfaces underneath the water. The caissons have now been underwater inspected. And they're getting more evaluation because the conclusion on the caissons was they're in fair to poor condition. And depending upon the loading that's going to be used on top of the caissons, you may or may not have to replace them, but you definitely are going to have to shore them up. That's what the current report says after an actual physical underwater review has been done. But what I wanted to point out is, again, thanks, Monica, for reminding me. Again, a lot of the money we've spent has to be done for whatever it is you build, whatever you build. Unless, the only way we've wasted that money is if we don't build a pier and we have an open waterfront. And there are people who are advocating for that, although it is one of the smaller groups or contingencies, but there are people who, yes, they...
The
double
square,
yeah.
That's the caissons.
Right.
And does not the entire pyramid rest on those caissons?
Yes.
That's a small footprint.
And the pyramid structurally itself, is it not solid?
Well, I don't know what you mean by solid, but here's, I can tell you what the report says. I can tell you what the report says. There was a report done by a company called Professional Services Incorporated. It's part of the exhibits, the advisory task force. It's on the internet. You can go look at all of these reports. What that report said was the entire, if you are going to redo the pyramid, keep it and refurbish it, the entire inside has to be gutted. And it has to be fully ADA compliant, which it isn't. And they recommended, and the peer advisory task force said, it is generally advised that it is economically infeasible. I'm just telling you what the report said. I don't know, but somebody was paid to look at that building, and they said, you're going to have to tear everything out of there. And you're going to have to replace it all. You're going to have to bring it up to code, none of which needs Florida building code now, because it was built in 1976, before Charlie, before
73.
What was the one in Homestead? Yeah, before Andrew. Anyway, and concludes, it's economically impractical to do that.
So whether it's whether it's the lens or the whole pier or whatever, they would still be either one would be sitting on those caissons.
Perhaps the lens may use some of the caissons. Again, it's not a finished thing. And the loading, what's really important is you know the condition. Now you've got to decide what the loading is, because the fair condition may actually support the load of the lens as opposed to the load of the pyramid. I don't know what that, but there's all engineering formulas that you do. So they haven't decided what the loading is going to be and where, because it's not completely finished. Yes. Ladies first. Will you yield your time, sir?
Sure. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I just had a couple questions based on the proposal. First being with the Columbia restaurant, has there been any other restaurant groups submitting their request to put a venue there?
I don't know if anyone has submitted a response, but I believe you guys...
It seems pretty much in the bag. I mean, all I keep on hearing about is Columbia, and then they're going to take over with the extended open-air restaurant as well, so I just was wondering how many other submitting has been...
None.
Has the city requested? They gave them 30 days, you're saying?
An invitation was sent out.
An invitation?
For 30 days.
The Columbia gave the city a proposal. It was unsolicited.
Brought a proposal to the city. And based on state law, the city is then required to advertise for 30 days. And pretty much anybody who's interested.
And they advertise this on the city homepage? Where was this advertised? I'm just curious.
It was a proposal because by state law, it's the same time. I'm not exactly sure.
Okay. I do have two more questions. I'll make it quick. Okay. My main thing is I see a lack of entertainment going on here with the Lens proposal. So with that being said, the main draw, according to what I see, is the 200-foot marina. And so I'm just curious, are we expecting boats to go into the marina and circle around and maybe dock and party? Or what is the big draw of bringing your boat in there versus cruising along the bay or to the ocean side? I'm just trying to understand why boats would find it fascinating to go into the circle.
Well, the idea is that the boats would come, the people would get up, they'd have a place to dock, mm-hmm. which today, there are docks at the current pier,
right.
but nobody uses them because the water's too rough. No, nobody docks their 24-foot boat at the pier. And so the idea was, let's make it accessible to those boaters who are out there so they can come and look and go eat or walk or whatever.
So the kayaks are supposed to navigate around the motorized vehicles that are going to be swimming or, boating around in a circle. Is that what we're anticipating? Or
yeah.
Okay. One more question.
I've never been on the Rainbow River. You've done that before.
Okay. There was mention of no... Well, my question isn't about price, sir. My question has to do with entertainment, so you can ask your question afterwards. Thank you. Yes, and how are the vendors going to get out to this open-air cafe? I see there's no mention of actual access for vehicles other than the trolley system.
Yeah.
So are they going to be taking their goods out on the trolley system out there?
The way I understand it is the supply will use the tram route, but there'll be vendors via the
same route to the cars. Called cars.
Okay. And the most important question I have has to do with the lifespan. There was mentioning of 75-year lifespan, so in 75 years, I know I won't be around, but will we be looking at another pier then? Is that what the question? The question is a 75-year lifespan, according to what we're presenting here.
There is a 75-year life design objective.
Okay.
Everybody, all the designers, the engineers, are working to a design objective of 75 years.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Okay, thank you.
So when they do their studies, the reason I say that is when they do their studies, they say, how long does this coating last? This coating lasts 30 years. It doesn't last 75 years. So you're going to have to recoat it. How long do these materials last in a marine environment? So you're going to have to do it twice. All of the design life of 75 years is what's used to cost and put together the design. Okay. It's not a guarantee that it lasts 75 years. It's a design criteria that says, in order to meet 75 years, I got to do this, 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 this. Yes. Young man, we took the mic away.
It's Leonard Schmidt. Just a quick question. I am one of those people that do, on the current pier, ride my bike out there, and I take my dog with me, and he's on the leash, and we do the loop around that. So that would be good. And I think as far as that ramp on the end, I don't think we want to take away Tampa's malfunction junction, do we? But I think we should just figure out how to make that work better. But my question is this. I think in the beginning of the presentation you mentioned 17 minutes, if I remember right, for the evacuation, and 2 minutes to go for cover if a sudden storm pops up. Where is the cover that you go under for the to get to in 2 minutes, especially if it's, raining sideways?
Yeah, that was wrong.
That wasn't what I said. It was, according to the model that was done, 13 minutes to completely evacuate. And if there's a fire, in any building, if there's a fire, and you have to go to an exit, a stairwell, it could take you, say, a minute to get to that stairwell. Once you're in that stairwell, you're in a safe zone. That stairwell is a rated assembly. So to get from what is considered a point on that pier where you're safe. The equivalent of an exit is there will take 2 minutes, according to, it's all based on fire egress. We're not talking about getting out of a storm event. Obviously, if there's a storm, a major storm coming, this canopy can only do so much. You're going to have to get off the pier, or you're going to, you know, stay at, you know, under the canopy as best you can. It's not what I was referring to is fire egress, not a storm safe
zone. And you mean how many people can be out of the rain at once?
No, I know.
Yes.
Hi, Pam Shishan. I have two questions. One, is there going to be some sort of a public service announcement telling tourists a lightning storm is coming, you better get off the pier, because they don't realize that they need to do that. So that's my first question. My second question is, and it looks like a nice place to take a walk after you've come downtown to eat. So putting out something just saying, here, make, you know, say we're interested, I don't think is enough. Is there some city department that is soliciting some other restaurants, such as Legal Seafood, a Chart House, a Bubba Gump's, something we don't have down here? Because as far as the Columbia, it's like been there, done that, and the food wasn't that good anyway.
I think the answer to that is the invitation was published pursuant to state law. That's what was done. And that's what was done. Nick.
Thanks, Charlie. Hi, Nick Weathersby, resident of St. Pete. The three finalists in the International Design Competition, when they were given their instructions by the city, were they told that the peer advisory task force recommendations were well-intentioned but short-sighted?
I think there was a correspondence or a letter or a document of some type that accompanied the bid materials that said programmatically, we're not going to hold you to 30,000 square feet of restaurant, 5,000 square feet of retail, and I think the words you used were, they're either exactly like that or something.
Yeah, they said well-intentioned or short-sighted. Yeah.
It was in the context of don't hold yourself to the programmatic recommendation.
So all the years of work they did to come up with all that, those recommendations, where they were told to basically forget about that. As programmatically, which is the most important part of the peer, I would think.
That may be your interpretation to forget about it. I think the intention was, and the way I read it is, don't limit yourself to that. I think those are two different things. That's the way I read it.
Yes. Thank you.
Did you have anything else, Nick?
No, thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Oh, James Marucci. I got a book here, but at the same time, I think I'm going to beat this dead horse here. I really need to know what's going to happen there as far as family entertainment, more than like 15, 20 minutes of going there, walking around, doing the loop. I mean, there's got to be something more to attract. I mean, earlier you had said activity versus,
active versus passive.
Okay, well, active. Activeness is what creates money, isn't it? Being active, having things, activity for people to be able to do. is that create money? Because people have, are spending when they're doing that, don't they?
Well,
they spend when they're being active in an active environment, right?
I think the answer to your direct question is, if you don't do anything, you're not going to make money, if that's what you're asking me. But I think you're looking at it wrong.
I'm looking at the pictures and I'm trying to figure out where I'm after 20, 30 minutes, what am I going to do? I'm trying to figure this out, and I don't see any of that in the pictures.
What I was trying to point out was the difference between active and passive had to do with whether you addressed the subsidies by increasing revenues or decreasing expenses. You can do it both ways. And passivity does, the other thing I think you need to understand is, from a stewardship point of view, it's about quality of life. It's not about making money. The way Charlie Gerdes looks at it is, it's about quality of life for your investment. And
something has to pay for it, right? I mean, not just the TIF fund that's going to create, that's going to pay for the project, but it's going to actually continue on for 30, 40, 50 years, continue on paying for it. But what's going to pay for it? I mean, the things, the activities on it.
Your tax dollars.
It's the budget in the Parks Department.
Your tax dollars.
Are we asking?
It's the budget in the what now?
I'll answer it. It's the $600,000 comes from your tax dollars, just like the $1.5 million is coming from your tax dollars. The idea is to drive that down.
With less activity, right?
Yes. Less expense.
Great.
If you have less activity, you have less expense.
Vote yes. Vote yes. Thank you.
You know what you're going to do? Because it's against the law to be an advocate in this forum, you're going to make me shut it down. Everybody's going to have to leave because you're advocating a position.
Sorry. Okay? I apologize.
Thank you.
Just a quick update. The Rays are up 2-0.
Thank you.
Background in aerospace engineering and a lot of the testing that we have here. And I'm looking
at
this.
You understand the similar metals?
That and much more.
Yeah.
Especially when it regards to aerospace environment, where you have all that above. The question that I have is somewhat twofold. One is, what kind of model simulation testing will be done? And if you could expand upon that, whether using computer as well as a scale model. The second question, part of this, is regards to the canopy itself. The canopy appears to be a large wing. And when I see water hitting a wing, it has to go somewhere. What is the catch basin process for that on the, if I say this properly, on the windward side, where the rain comes straight down, then what is also the water catch basin philosophy or driving engineering for? For the underneath side, when the rain is coming forward, and it has to go somewhere, so it's going to catch on the inside of the canopy and go somewhere. So you have rain on both sides. So what's the philosophy, and also what's the engineering strategy?
Well, I can't tell you what the philosophy and the engineering strategy is, because I'm neither one of those.
Or design.
I can tell you that...
Can your architect here resolve that?
The reason I went to get my book was because I can tell you that this company, that it's a company called RWDL. They are the wind testing and wind analysis environmental company who will be doing the testing. They've already completed the computer modeling. They are going to do scale model, full-blown wind tunnel testing. That's what the last part of the $869,000 that was approved most recently.
Do we have the results of the computer simulation modeling?
Yes, and they're in the book.
Okay.
Would you like to, you can go on the internet, and you can go to book number 3, Schematic Design, and...
I didn't know if there's any updates because the design has changed.
The design hasn't changed from the time they did the desktop to now.
You've added extra supports and changed the modeling of...
They've added the extra supports as a result of the desktop.
Okay.
That's what I was pointing out, yeah.
The next question.
So this RWDL company, who by the way has wind tested, if you go on their website, it's RWDL, they're out of Canada, if you go on their website, you will see that they have tested some of the most unbelievable buildings in the world. They are like in the top two or three companies that do this on the planet. So I'm telling you they're bona fides. They're, you know, that they're real and they're professionals.
Well, that wasn't the question, whether we realized the process is what's the next step.
And it's in the
right. So the next step is the actual scale model testing.
That's right.
Okay. Then the other part of that question is the catch basin for the water. How is the water going to be formed, and what's the design principle to catch that water as it lands on the canopy from on top, and also from on, you know, from the western side?
And again, my answer is the same, that that's part of what they're doing. I mean, they understand that it's over water. They're going to use water in the scale model. They're not going to use a dry building.
No. Just to restate the question is, in the design, I don't see it addressed as to where that water is going and how it's going to be utilized in the runoff. That's my question.
There will be a gutting system on the lower perimeter of the canopy.
Go to the Tampa Bay.
question answer.
Okay.
Any others?
No, that's it. Thank you.
I'm trying to. You haven't asked one yet, right there. Yeah, two.
You stated your contention earlier that at this new pier we'll be able to do everything that we can do at the current pier.
I think I said almost everything, but yeah.
Okay, because I respectfully disagree. I can't be in the air condition that I'm enjoying tonight there. But
I think I said that.
Okay. My question is the Columbia Cafe as part of this design, since you say you're still hashing it out? You don't know if it's going to be outdoor, indoor, what it's going to be. Is that part of the $50 million that is part of it?
Yeah.
And that's already been funded? I mean, that's already been planned?
The space for it is part of the $50 million. They'll have to outfit it. I mean, we're not going to outfit their restaurant for them, if that's what you're asking me. The space that they would put this 3,200 square foot outdoor grill in is in the $50
million. That's in the $50 million, yes. Okay.
Yes, all the way back.
Thank you, Howard Taylor. Could you pull up that the schematic, or show the layout of the promontory very quickly? And while that's pulling up, just a point of clarification, you keep referring to the international design contest, the 23 design teams, and 9 and 3. Not a big deal, people should know. 23 design teams submitted resumes, only 3 actual designs were ever seen. I believe that's correct. Mm-hmm. So
I don't know if it's 9 designs that were seen. There were only three concepts.
Okay. But anyway, on the promontory here, looking at the space usage, I know they talk about using having community events there. And you look at the you have the restrooms, the ice cream stand. You obviously can't have an event in the turnaround for vehicles or on the overwater drive. The cafe, Columbia Cafe, that's going to take up its own space. Got elevators and fishing in the back. So you've got the learning steps as a possible spot. So it could be an event that only can be done on steps. And it has no cover there. With that taken into account, I don't see a lot of space where you can really have a community event. Can you help me out here?
I don't mean to be judgmental and sarcastic. We have theater in the park at Demon's Landing. We have If you go down to Beach Drive right now, there are hundreds of people sitting outside eating and drinking.
I understand that, and we agree with it completely.
People get married on the beach every single weekend.
I'm just saying, in the materials for the lens, it talks about there being community events and what was outside. And that's why I'm asking it here.
And you pointed out where they could be.
No, he asked you where they could be.
Yeah.
Are
he asked you. On the steps for 200 people?
Yeah.
That's it. There's no other bigger event could be held there.
Probably not.
Probably not. So not a big event. There's not big event space like they say. Event space. Couldn't have a wedding over a couple hundred people. I don't even know where they would sit unless on the steps.
Have over a couple hundred people. 6,000 people could watch
the fireworks
out of the structure.
Separate event.
I don't see where they're going to be when 200. That whole big learning steps is 285 already.
Okay.
I don't know where you're going to put 6,000 people.
You can have a community event with 285 people.
And that's it.
And that's it.
That's it.
How many bathrooms for 285?
Or 6,000.
Yes. The 5-foot boardwalk she's asking about, what's the purpose of having a 5-foot boardwalk as opposed to just keeping the same surface as the rest of it? Is it just to offset it?
Does it introduce wood to EK, long lasting hardwood?
And that same wood feature is in some parts of the overwater drive and overwater bridge. That's true, right? The overwater drive also has a 5-foot boardwalk kind of
the drive.
Yes.
Charlie, first, thank you for doing this tonight. I didn't say that earlier. I apologize to you for speaking over at times. ignorance, however, is difficult.
I get off steady on
you. I have to, my question has to do with the building of the process, but I got to say, I really appreciate that I would now have a place I could park my boat if I wanted to go with my friends downtown by boat. I could come park in the inner marina and then walk to the downtown area for restaurants or for events or whatever that might be. But my question is essentially, are we going to build this to the city code, which will in turn answer the wind load questions, the drainage questions? It's going to be built to code.
It's going to be built to the Florida Building Code, I believe is the answer. It's the Florida Building Code, which takes into account all of the hurricane safety stuff.
So at that point, the ramp that is for everybody, not just bicycles, is ADA compliant then, I assume. And again, that's for everybody to use. We're not building a bike racetrack for the bicyclists to use only by themselves, from what I understand. So it's...
I mean, it will be built to code. Late at night, they might have bike drag races, I don't know.
You never know.